Yeah, my family was there. Sean, my drum tech, I think carried my mom home, carried my sister home.
That's hilarious.
Me and my girl were arguing. I think I was crying that night. We were loving and hating and all of it. It was fun.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome me and join Jose Pasillas and Meytal Cohen here today? All right.
Hi, guys.
I want to say how happy I am that both of you are here today. I started this Renman Music and Business website about 3 months ago, and it kind of had a very simple idea to the whole thing. I wanted to see if I could help some young musicians and folks that wanted to be in the music industry as professionals kind of find a way to navigate their way around today's music business. And I thought that the best way to do that is to kind of invite everybody, all the participants in that process into the equation. So each week I've been inviting folks who are their music professionals, musicians, up-and-comers in the business to be part of this conversation. And I just think it's so important that people like yourself are willing to share in that. So I just want to thank you for joining us here today on the show.
Cool.
I want to start off with a little background here. Most of the folks that are watching today, Jose, probably know a lot about you. What they don't know, we'll fill you in on a little bit later. But most of our Incubus fans, for sure, are just getting to know you, Meytal Cohen. And so I wanted to start off at the top and take a moment for you to tell us a little bit about Meytal Cohen.
Wow, that's gonna be, how much time do you have?
As long as you need.
It's the internet.
All right. I am an Israeli drummer. I don't know if I have to say Israeli. Well, I came here to the U.S. from Israel when I was 21, kind of a long time ago. And I came here to follow a dream of being a drummer. I come from a really big family. My entire family is kind of more professional. Like, they're either doctors or lawyers. My mom kind of just, I don't know, she was very influential. And everyone's like, what are you going to do? I think we need some doctors.
Drumming wasn't really on her list.
Yeah, exactly. So I came here right after I got out of the army. I wasn't playing for a very long time. I started playing really kind of late, but I knew that it's kind of now or never type of thing because I was already 21 and it was time to either go to school and be like a, you know, something or do it now and escape that route. So I did that and I came here and I went to a music school for a couple of years. I actually broke my back and then I went back to Israel when I recovered. I broke 3 vertebrae in a accident. And
car accident?
Yeah. Oh. I went with some people from school that I didn't really know that well and we end up rolling off a small cliff.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And so I went back to Israel and I was wearing this body brace for a full half year and then I came back and I finished school. And then kind of one thing led to another, and here I am.
Yeah, it's an interesting story, but you mentioned a word there that we talk a lot about on the site, and is really kind of one of the premises, and that's this whole notion of dreaming something, and then moving from the dreaming, which is kind of the easy part, right, to the doing it. And I think you've got a great story here, which we'll talk a little bit more about here. Jose, you know, we've got tons of questions, by the way, folks. I don't know how many folks are in the broadcast right now, but it's big today, folks. And so we're going to be answering everybody's questions. We had a whole bunch of people that submitted their questions prior to the broadcast on our live stream event page. We're going to be taking a bunch of those questions, although more and more keep coming in. So if we don't answer your question, we'll try to get back to you on it. But a bunch of questions out there and for both of you, but I'll start with one for Jose. Stacy Acevedo and Perla, well, I'm not sure where Perla is from, both had a couple questions for you, Jose, and they kind of speak to this notion of the dream it and do it. Jose, Stacy wanted to know, Jose, when was the first time you realized you wanted a career in music? And Perla, secondly, wanted to know what got you interested and playing drums, and was your family supportive of it?
Yeah, let's see. I don't know exactly when I sort of thought that drumming could be a career. That was probably a later thought, after I'd been playing drums and we'd been playing in a band for a while. It was merely a hobby for the first few years. I never really thought that this could be a career, you know? So we were just basically killing time, you know, when we were 15, 16, 17. And what inspired me to start playing drums was my neighbor, most people know the story who know anything about me. My neighbor was the drummer from Guns N' Roses, Steven Adler, the ex-drummer.
That's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, super cool. So I just remember being 11, 12, 13, and waking up in the middle of the night to drums, like hearing drums.
In the middle of the night.
And my parents, you know, were livid, and the neighbors were calling the cops, and everyone was just upset. And I was sitting up in bed thinking this was awesome. like couldn't believe it, you know, like it sounded so cool. And so like from that from that point, I started slowly going over there and asking Steven, can I sit behind your drum kit, you know? And he'd be like, yeah, come on in, man, come on in.
How old were you?
I think I was 13 or 14.
Now, this is after they've already broken big.
Yeah, so this is when Appetite started, a little bit before, because he was home. And so I would go over, and I would literally sit behind this, behind his kit, and wouldn't touch anything. And it was this big double kick drum, like sparkly white DW kit. And I would just sit there, and there was like this distinct smell in that place. Nothing bad, but it was like cigars and booze or something. It wasn't a bad smell, but I just remember always walking up to the garage, because that's where his studio it was made out of, his garage. And it just always stuck with me for some reason. He would always be sitting like in the control room watching TV or doing whatever he was doing. And I'd sit there for like just a few minutes and then I'd leave. I'd be like, thanks, I'm out of here. So kind of around that time, I remember just starting to listen to music and stuff that I was interested in, and not so much like music that my parents had on around the house or in the car. And I was always just listening to the drums. Like just, I was able to start distinguishing different drum sounds and looking back at videos, because my dad did a good job of taking a lot of video of us when we were kids. I just see, like I remember a specific video of me playing air drums while taking a bath to Purple Rain. And I forget what's, I think it was Take Me With You, but the intro of the song is a big drum roll. And I remember doing that, and like totally, it looked like I knew what I was doing, like I was hitting the right notes and whatever. And so just looking back, I was like, wow, like I was really meant to play drums. And so, you know, that's kind of where it started.
Interesting. Meytal and I had a chance to talk yesterday. You had a fun story about your early days of banging around. Tell our viewers.
Are you talking about the tap dancing?
Your tap dancing, and then your pension. You took tap dancing into banging on drums, and what kind of got you inspired to do it?
I kind of always remember listening to the drums, like you said, like always listening. I have this. A really good memory of my brothers blasting Duran Duran's Wild Boys in the car, and it's so like drum oriented, and I would freak out. I couldn't believe it. It was like the best thing I've ever heard. So I remember asking my mom if I could drum, and she had like a really bad experience. And my brother, actually, she got him a drum set when he was younger, and he ripped the drum heads, and she was sure that it's broken. She's like, no, he ripped the heads, and I had to pay, you know, for the recital. I don't know, she rented the kit, or I don't know, some retard, stupid story like that. Yeah. And so she didn't let me get a drum set, but she enrolled me into a tap dancing class. And I really loved it. It's geeky, but I did that.
I love
that.
Tap dance too.
Yeah, do you?
What's the name from the I'm Fred totally Astaire. Blanking. No. Gregory small Knight. Small black dude.
Sammy Davis.
Sammy Davis Jr.
Sammy Davis, baby. Mr. Showbiz.
I've always, like, for some reason, I was geeking on him, like, as I was a kid to now, just his tap dancing and his, like, vibe. Like, it was the coolest thing ever.
I would
love to tap dance.
You're one of your fans, Meytal. I know your parents were very supportive. All the parents of Incubus were very supportive.
Yeah.
That's amazing. You guys are so lucky. It's just how rare it is for guys in high school to just, like, everyone's freaking amazing and they just happen to be in the same class together. who does that happen to?
I feel very, very fortunate. And my parents were awesome. Like, I got a kit. Actually, I stole Mike's stepdad's kit and kept it in my house, and I'd play every day, and they were totally cool with it. You know, I was pretty respectful, never played early in the morning or late at night, just right in the middle of the day, and they never said a thing. It was really cool.
Now, let me ask you guys a question, and it's funny, one of your fans, I'll just give a shout-out to him. You might have already answered the question, Meytal. A guy by the name of Mark Purcell asked, was your family supportive of you playing drums and so forth, and it sounds like...
No.
It wasn't. And do you think part of that was a cultural thing, being from Israel, where that felt a little frivolous as opposed to something more meaningful?
I do think so. In Israel, I don't think artists get a lot of respect. They don't make a lot of money. They're like, if you want to be poor, go and be a musician in Israel. It's just like, so.
It's the same here, I think.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's kind of maybe an international kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I feel like here you do, like, if you do make it, you can be very successful. Yeah. And it's just, it's not the same in Israel. I can show you, like, the top artists that are barely making a living.
Right.
There's actually a few artists from Israel that I've been contacted by that are on our Renman Music and Business site. So I think there's more of it happening now than perhaps there was in the past. But it's interesting how those go. Speaking of family, Jose, like I say, we had tons of questions here today, and we're going to jump around a little bit, so you folks feel, you two, join in whenever you want. Mark Hayden is a big Incubus fan, I know, because I've frequent these online chat boards, as you might imagine. He goes, Jose, now that you're a father, how do you juggle family life and music? Do you bring them, the wife and kids, on tour with you?
I mean, not for extended amounts of time, but when I can, if we're hubbed out in a city for a few days, they'll come out and visit. Did I start touring, you know, and being away from the family. The first 3 years, I was full-time dad at home with Frankie and my girl. And so just over this last record cycle, I was really starting to deal with it. And so there's, you know, a lot of Skype every day. There's Skyping. And then when they can, they come out. And for the first time this last tour, Frankie slept on the bus overnight, which was awesome. You know, our plans changed. Like, I wasn't planning on having her spend the night on the bus, but we had to, you know, be rerouted because of a storm. And so they came on the bus, and she loved it. She absolutely loved it. She did well, slept through the night, didn't keep anyone up. It was super cool.
Four.
Yeah. All three Pasillases in the same bunk?
No. They had bottom bunk, and then I had the bunk above them. But it was really cool. Like, that's one of my... During one of these summer tours, I'm gonna get my own bus and have them out for the summer.
Would
like that's.
She love that.
Yeah. She loves going to daddy's work.
Yeah, would. I can't imagine how it is to, like, have your dad be doing that, like an artist.
Right. That's she's oblivious to all of it. She just knows that daddy goes to work and leaves for a long period of time, and it's very difficult for her. She's better now, but in the beginning, like, she would wake up at night, like, calling for me and be really sad. You could tell it was, like, affecting her. But she's gotten better, and we've all gotten better at it, actually, you know. It was difficult.
It's funny to hear you say that, you know, because I've known you since you were 19 years old. And I refer to you guys as kids, even though we're not. So now to hear Jose Pasillas' father and drummer, where the drummer and the other stuff kind of move down the list when you're a father. It's interesting to see how your children relate to you. No matter what you do, you're just dad.
Yep.
You know, they don't process it. And when you have kids one day, if you choose to do that, it's the same kind of thing. The relationship changes a lot there. So hopefully everybody's got it. Do you have something to say there? Feel free to jump in here, Meytal. I'm still practicing this chat show host scenario. Okay, so everybody's got a chance to get to know you a little bit. One of the things I love about this Renman Music and Business side is I've had a bunch of my music business buddies come in here, and I've learned two things. Not nearly as many people give a shit about it based on the numbers we're seeing here today. But the site is Music and Business, and that's where, for any of the folks that are out there watching that aspire as a musician or an artist to do it, it's got to start with great music, right? And so let's talk about the music side of what you're doing here, the drumming. You guys are drummers. Here's a question I know you've been asked before, Jose. I asked you just the other day, so we did a little homework. Frankie Norfolk, who I'm not sure where Frankie, if I was a better host, I'd figure out where they were from. Frankie Norfolk wants to know, Jose, who are some of your favorite bands who inspire you and the rest of the band? And who are your favorite drummers?
We actually, as far as music and the band, we had a lot of similar tastes in the beginning. We do now as well, but we were listening to the same bands, which were in the early 90s to mid 90s was an amazing time for rock music and alternative rock music. So Primus was one of the bands that me and Mike were geeking on, you know.
What's the drummer's name?
Tim Alexander.
Okay, we got him. We got a little clip of the show. So you set me up here, Jose.
So Primus, Tim Alexander. It was funny, Mike and our old bassist, Alex, and Brandon a little bit too, were into like a lot of heavy metal, like Iron Maiden and Metallica. I never was. We ended up doing a lot of covers of that just because, you know, I wanted to play drums and that's what they wanted to do, and I was totally cool with it. But I was listening to like punk bands like Firehose and 7 Seconds and Bad Brains and stuff like that. So Firehose was another band. Okay. George Hurley was the drummer.
Yeah.
And I remember going to see them like at the Palomino and little clubs in LA, and the drummer George had like a stack of splash cymbals, like a little tree, and he would do a solo and just do it on his little cymbals. So that's when you see like a solo of mine, I kind of steal that from him. But he was a big inspiration to me. John Bonham from Led Zeppelin was a big one, and Stuart Copeland, okay, probably the most borrowing of ideas that
we got a little clip here to show you for all you drummer folks out there. The part I love about this is two of your favorite drummers were in two bands that I love, which is of no particular significance other than great music spans generations, so that an old guy like me can be connecting with an 18-year-old and talk about John Bonham. So play the little clip there if you would, Darren. All right, folks, I want to talk about some famous drummers there. Those folks have done some drums. Meytal, who are your favorite drummers or bands that you either borrow from or inspired by? Influenced.
Well, really, all the people that I cover, like the majority, you could go through them and see my influences. But if I could name just a few, it would actually also be Primus, Tim Alexander, Danny Carey from Tool.
Yeah.
Awesome. Jose is actually a big, big influence. And I was going through a song and I was like, wow, I really do that also. And it's like things that come in and you don't actually realize that people influence you, and then suddenly it's in your stuff. Abe Cunningham from Deftones.
Awesome.
So you have a decidedly, you know, we talked about this the other day, you have a decidedly hard rock metal streak through you, Meytal. Tell us where that comes from. Are these just bands? Did you have brothers that played this stuff? I always wonder, because the harder rock stuff is not typically the stuff that a nice girl like you would be associating with.
No, it did not came from my family at all. Like, I remember Saturday morning, because we're such a big family, like, this sister would listen to George Michael, there was some Roxette going on, Madonna, like, nothing, like, heavy at all. But I think high school, like late high school, not even like, you know, like the cool kids in middle school. My first boyfriend gave me a CD and it had just like a bunch of everything, Deftones in it, and I loved it. It was an instant, like, this is music. This is what it's supposed to be. And
was it the drumming? The drumming that intrigued you, or just
like
everything?
Syncopated drumming is the thing that I love most. That's why I really
it's the hardest
like,
thing.
Yeah. So like just interesting. You don't know what's going on. But then also just the powerfulness of it, like, you know, Metallica, the Black Album, like just everything sounds big and powerful and it just makes you want to headbang. It's
It's for me, you know, you mentioned some of those bands I worked with back in the day as a concert promoter, and I say it all the time. I love the big rock. I love the power of it. I love just the big theater of it all. And having a chance to be a promoter, I got to see so many great drummers doing wild tricks, Tommy Lee spinning over the crowd. I watched John Bonham when I was 16 years old, watch Moby Dick.
That's sweet.
Watch that intro and so many of those things. And so it's interesting to hear somebody like yourself. One of your fans, Jose, Rain, I don't know if that's a guy or a girl, so pardon me. I'll just say Rain said, Hoser, do you enjoy... Actually, I said Hoser.
They didn't Hoser.
Say, do you enjoy metal songs, Jose? If yes, state your favorite metal bands, definitively. Go on record.
I would say Vulgar Display of Power from Pantera was one of my highlights. That record...
That's a good one.
That record just sounds so big and the drums are so clean sounding and
he's
just
amazing.
Like...
amazing. I should have mentioned them also.
You feel free. It's the internet. Jump right in here.
That record is just so awesome and so heavy, you know, and I remember listening to it and he had like an old Cadillac or something with subs in the back and that double bass was just booming and it was awesome. That's probably a highlight for metal music for me.
Oh, gotta love it. Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, since we're talking about drummers now, and I love the way you refer to it. Jose did, we did an event back in last year at the Incubus HQ where Jose did a drum clinic, and you affectionately referred it as geek, doing drummer geek with all the folks, and Jose was holding court there and so forth, and it was
geeking
terrific.
Out.
Geeking out on drum stuff, right? So you guys feel free to geek out, but I have a couple of geeked out questions here. So some of our buddies, our drummers out there, want to know some technical stuff. So I'll throw the first one at you. This one question's for Meytal. It's from a gentleman by the name of Robert Palmer. He says, hey, Meytal. Have you been thinking of making any technique switches since a good number of years playing, like switching to open hand playing as Dom Famularo did, or perhaps the quickly evolving swivel technique for the feet like George Koleos, Gene Hoagland, etc.? Right over my head. Take that question.
Actually, I'm not into like all the terms, and I'm not a very good person to ask these questions. I do what makes it sound good, and I'm not even sure what it's called. Like, I know there's a molar thing that people refer to. I'm not sure. I know that even when it comes to like hand of how to grip the stick, I kind of have some middle weird thing that I do, which is not here nor there.
It just works for you. You find what works for you.
What about you? Do you
same?
Have,
I never took lessons or was properly trained, so I just sort of figured it out on my own. And I don't know if my technique is necessarily good or bad. It's just what works for me. But it's even funny because my right foot on my pedal, I noticed this just like a year or two ago. I keep it half off of the
me
pedal.
Me too, like that, in diagonal.
Like just this part is on it for whatever. I think it's because I know exactly where my foot is if I could feel the side of the pedal. Mm-hmm. So like me and Ben were just talking about it the other day when we were playing. I was like, do you notice that my foot's like halfway off the pedal? People would be freaking out with like how horrible that is, you know, if they knew. And like it's literally like it's just kind of funny, you know. That's
what do you mean? Only this part is on.
So, like, say here's the edge of the pedal. Yeah. Here's the pedal. Uh-huh. Instead of having it right on it, it's half off like that.
Oh, that's yes. weird.
So I could just feel exactly where my foot is on the edge of it, and
for
you know,
me, it's
that's
all,
not proper
it's,
technique.
It's just it's also half off, but it sounds like yours is straight and mine
yeah,
is kind of
like
a duck.
Angle. Yeah. You know,
whatever works.
Yeah, whatever
just
works.
Do
whatever you
think.
Feel comfortable.
Yeah,
it's funny to hear you guys. I love hearing you guys talk. I'm just, folks, did I mention how much I love the internet? I really do with this whole idea. But listening to you guys talk about, you know, drumming and your technique reminds me, I'm a big golfer, right? And what's interesting about it, there are certain, quote, fundamentals, I suppose, in drumming right. and or golf. But the interesting thing is, at a certain level, everybody has their own instinctual, unique blend of those things. And so for me to hear you guys talking about this, I just love it because I've watched both of you play. And it went from where a person like me sits, they don't see all that stuff because it just feels great. It just feels like you guys are on it. And for the layperson, they don't see it. But
even drummers, I would say, don't completely see or know what's going on, you know, even just from listening to it, which is one of the reasons why, you know, I just recently started putting a camera just on me playing, you know, our songs when we were playing a concert, and that's just actually showing what I'm doing, because there's a lot of ghost notes and a lot of other things that aren't always, you know, audible, so it's cool just to actually see it, because in typical videos when you see bands, it's only a second on the drummer, a second on the bass, whatever. Yeah. You know, you don't, as a musician, I like to study what other musicians are doing. You know, I don't like being in the crowd like I used to when I was smaller and rocking out. I like to just focus and study. You know, those are my teachers that I'm looking at, you know, whoever that may be. Yeah. So like, that's why one of the reasons I just have a camera on me so other drummers can actually see exactly what I'm doing. And even though it's one camera and you don't see my footwork or anything, you know.
You should get more.
Yeah.
Then you have
more
a drum
cameras.
Cover.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to show some of your stuff a little bit later here. But because Meytal, you've got a camera set up for your videos that's sick that shows you all that technique and stuff. All right, I got another question. This one's for Jose. Another drummer geek question here. Pardon me, folks. I say that with the greatest respect. Kelly Curry says, my question is about playing live and the importance of staying loose, Hose. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when playing with my band, fun fact, I like it, promote the band, good job, I fail to stay loose and relaxed while playing. On those nights, I'll break a pair of sticks or two, completely drain my energy 30 minutes into a set, yeah. and just feel like I'm not playing at the top of my game, so to
right.
speak. And other times I prioritize the relaxation. I'm laughing, no broken sticks, no heart attacks. My conclusion, got to be loose to be tight. What yeah. do you do to stay relaxed behind the kit, especially for those long sets?
That's a good question. You know, I've tried a number of things, and what I've kind of figured out what works for me is, you know, just hanging out. I'm usually like, you know, watching Barry, you know, like something on TV, How It's Made or something, relaxing, hanging out on the bus before a show. I've tried warming up, I've tried like stretching, and what I've sort of come to is it's really, everything has to do with my mental, you know, with my psyche. So like if I'm stressing out or I'm anxious, it doesn't matter if I'm, you know, warming up for an hour, I'm just gonna be stiff and not relaxed, and I'm just gonna hack away at my drums. If, you know, I found that if I'm completely relaxed and I feel good and I'm playing really well, I may not have warmed up at all and could be having the best time of my life. So it really is, you know, kind of where my headspace is at. So I just try to maintain relaxed and not stress on anything, you know, and that's kind of my attitude about, you know, when I'm playing drums, is just to sort of have this
stay loose
attitude. Really.
How about you, Meytal?
Well, it's really different because I'm like in my comfort zone, but I totally know what he's talking about. Like, and that was actually a problem that I have. Like, well, I feel like the more you do it, the better you are. But like, let's say if I was on tour, And the first show of the tour, I was totally nervous. I was freaking out, and I was like also like that. But then the night after, and after 20 shows, you're like, eh, like yeah. whatever, it's okay. Yeah.
Nice segue to a question, a fan of yours from Brazil. Not around the corner, Brazil. We've been down there a couple times. Great, great country, Brazil. Milton Ricardo Azevedo asks, hi, Meytal. You're really awesome and a great inspiration to your fans here in Brazil. Can I just ask, how good does it feel to have some fans in Brazil?
It's unbelievable. Have you ever been to Brazil? No, I wish. I really feel like they're the warmest people and like the sweetest.
Jose, would you like to weigh in on the fans in Brazil?
South America, Brazil, I mean, it's probably one of the most liveliest, you know, places to go to like play music. It's great.
Yes, they are. Okay, so back to your question. Sorry, Milton, I didn't forget about you. The old questions. Are you thinking of forming a band, Meytal? You mentioned about being on tour. Have you been invited to join any group? You're amazing and deserve the energy of a huge crowd. I agree.
Yeah, that's so sweet.
Yeah. So, thinking about a band?
I am in the process of, but you know, this time has been really like eventful. Like, I don't know, something happened a few weeks back and like I've been so busy, like session and projects happening and collaborations. And a part of that is also me trying to like produce a song, which is coming along, but not quite there yet. Mm. I haven't found the, like, I wasn't fortunate enough to like be surrounded by amazing friends that are musicians. But I would love to find that. I feel like I went through a different route, and that's something that I'm lacking.
Well, we're going to talk about that route here in a second. We're going to come back to, you know, more some of the career side of this stuff. I'll play manager here a little bit. But before we do that, one of the things I was hoping we could do with this wacky little website of ours is actually have a real conversation with people where they can participate, they can ask you questions. It kind of goes two ways. For me, being the old school guy that I am, I still like talking to people on the phone, and so I still do that. And today, Jose, we've got one of our biggest Incubus fans on the planet, Jessica Thibodeau, who is from Nashville, Tennessee.
Oh, I see her on Twitter all the time.
Yes, you do. She's very famous, Jess is. I actually met Jess up at our show at the start of the Linkin Park tour in New York at Jones Beach.
Is that where she's from, New York?
No, she, like I said, she's a big Incubus fan, and she came up from Nashville to hook up with another Incubus fan.
That's funny.
Unbelievable Incubus networking. It almost has become a family, but that's a whole different show, your rock family. Anyway, we have Jessica on the phone today, who rather than me, she's going to ask the question herself. Jess, you there? Jessica, you there?
I'm here.
How much do we love this? Okay, Jess, where are you? In Nashville, Tennessee?
Yeah, I'm in Nashville.
Hi, Jess.
I'm sorry. I'm recovering from bronchitis,
So
my voice is like barely here.
You sound good.
Well, thank you. I'm trying. Like, I had went out to lunch with my grandparents, and I was like, hey, I can't speak. I have a very important talk call later.
All right, so you're here with Meytal Cohen and Jose Pasillas. You have a question for the Jose Pasillas man?
Yes, I have a question not for Jose, but for Hoser.
The Hoser, okay. We're big on nicknames. I don't know. I've never asked Hoser how he feels about that name, but, you know. Fire away, Jess.
Okay, cool. I want to talk about your art. I definitely see that you have something coming up with Scene 4, and it's your Art of Drums, where you were working with him on this project. And I wanted to know why you have waited so long to release your art, especially being friends with Brandon, who's been releasing his art since 2003. And I know that you guys have been doing art for a very long time. And so why the wait?
Good question. You know, I don't really have a great answer for it other than, you know, I've been painting and drawing all my life, and that's merely just an extension of, you know, my creative side. You know, it's just a hobby, and And so I never really, kind of like drumming in the beginning, I never planned to do anything with it. I just did it because I love to. So I've been painting all this time, and just, you know, just recently have I kind of thought about doing something, doing a gallery, and Scene 4 approached me to do the Art of Drums, which I thought would be a perfect opportunity for me to begin this process of putting my artwork out there. So I've just sort of waited this long because I kind of just don't know where to go, where to start, what to do. And I didn't really want to put too much effort into it just because we were working. I was working all the time on you know, in being the drummer of Incubus, and you know, we were busy. So that's sort of an excuse, actually. But I'm going to start. I'm starting now. So the Art of Drums is sort of the beginning, is sort of the beginning of that.
Well, I'm very excited because to see that Scene 4 has a lot of creative people that have been working with. So you've got a great lineup to see, like, Shavo of The Smoke Down and he and everybody. Like, I feel like it's going to be a very great projector for you. And I've also seen your print from the NBC Latino interview, and I was wondering if you planned on releasing those prints. Or are you going to make more prints? Like, are you going to have, like, exhibit anytime?
Yeah, I think so. I think I'm going to do, I'll do something, maybe some prints of that work, maybe some newer stuff that I have, that I've been working on as well. I'll slowly start that process, figuring out, you know, what to do. I kind of need direction. You know, I'm not really good with sort of organizing that stuff because I'm new to it. I don't know really how to go about it. So this is sort of the beginning of putting all that together. So I'll definitely have something, you know, for people to actually purchase. And this all will start happening probably within the next, you know, few months. So keep an eye out. I'm working on a website right now, which will be the focal point of all my artwork, so people can actually go someplace to see it and to buy things. So I'm at the brink of actually opening that up. So so stay tuned. And thanks for that question.
Jess?
Yeah, for sure. See, that's going to be launching November 1st. So I'm very excited for you.
Right. Thank you very much.
So now you had one
Thank
other.
Thank you. No problem. Thank you.
Jess, you had one other question while we got you on the phone here and it's all working. I feel like we should milk this, right? You had another question about a side project that Jose was working on?
Oh, yes, with Prashant. Oh, my God, I love it. Are you going to be touring with him at all, or were you just filling in for the tracks?
I think I will. No, I just...
tell us about the project. I'm not sure most people know.
Prashant Aswani is a solo artist, a guitar player. And he's
been amazing.
Absolutely incredible, talented musician. He's been putting out records, you know, for many years. And I just... contributed three songs to the record he put out a few months ago called Sonically Speaking. And one of, you know, those songs that I did with him are really cool. One in particular was just super fun. So after that, I ended up doing a complete record with him called Visions, which he's going to release probably in the next few months. So that's, I think, 10 or 12 tracks. And it sounds incredible. It was super fun. You know, I just got to do whatever I wanted and just kind of go off. So it was super fun. He's a super talented guy. And I got to do the artwork for his record on Visions, and actually did the artwork for his Sonically Speaking record as well. So it was just a cool project to be part of, and to play drums on it was super fun. And he's very inspiring. So that should be coming out in the next few months. You know, he's putting that all together now. He actually just got the CD the other day, so it's in the process of coming out. So, Prashant Aswani,
if you give her some information, we'll post it on the webpage there as well. Jess, I want to thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks, Jess.
Okay, and by the way, take care of yourself. Get well.
Yeah, feel
I
better.
I am, I swear.
All right, we'll see you
bye,
later. Jess. Thanks a lot.
Okay,
great. Our chat room is open too. All the places that you can reach out and touch somebody. We had a question for you, Meytal, from Andrew Rivera. Do we know where Andrew's from? We don't. Okay. Sorry for that, Andrew. This is for Meytal. It says, I love your technique, Meytal. Would you ever do a cover of Perfect Circle's The Noose?
Oh, he's funny. I think he asked for that a few times. Maybe I caught that one time. Yeah, I love A Perfect Circle.
Yeah.
I probably should cover that. So I'll definitely consider that.
All right, there you have it, Andrew. That's as good as it's going to get for you today.
Josh Freese is
he's amazing.
He's the go-to man.
Like, unbelievable.
If you're looking for a drummer.
Let me ask you this, Meytal. You know, Jose, you've been working, obviously, doing some other things on the side. Because of what's going on in your career now, do you get offers to be playing as a session person and so forth? And who you've been working with? Anybody we would know?
Recently, I recorded 3 tracks for Akira Yamaoka. He's actually a video game composer. He composed for Silent Hill. It's a horror video game. Do you know that?
Yeah.
Game.
Awesome game.
So I recorded for a new video game called Killer is Dead. It's supposed to be released in 2013. And I'm actually, I haven't officially announced it yet, but I'm going on tour in Mexico in November.
Sweet.
With him, and it's going to be pretty amazing. And yeah, I do get session work, and a lot of opportunities come in because of my videos, and it seems to flourish.
We're going to talk about that just in a second, but I will say that, speaking of Mexico, I know that we have tons of our fans, Incubus fans and Jose's fans in particular, down in Mexico that are watching here today. So, you know, if you'll give us some information on it, we'll post it on the website after the event, on the event, so people can keep up to speed about it. How about, remember that dinner we had in Mexico?
My family was there. We were rocking. There was a lot of drunkenness and crying and hugging and loving.
There was a lot of hugging and loving.
Do you have family there?
Yeah, my family was there. Sean, my drum tech, I think carried my mom home, carried my sister home.
That's hilarious.
Me and my girl were arguing. I think I was crying that night. We were loving and hating and all of it. It was fun.
Viva la Mexico, yeah. I tell you. It was fun times. I won't tell you what I was doing, but that was an awesome,
that was one of the most awesome
Incubus family dinners of all time.
Yeah, and that show was sweet too the next night.
Well, remember that was outside some stadium.
The parking lot of the stadium.
Yeah, you're going to love it down there in Mexico. So all our Incubus Mexico fans, you take care of our friend Meytal. All right, so let's talk a little bit now. You know, we've gotten through the drum stuff and getting to know you. So let's talk a little bit about building a career and so forth. I'm going to focus on you. Jose, you've had a very traditional career path as a successful musician. You started in a band. You started very young, which might be a little bit atypical. You got signed to a record deal when you were 19 years old. You got signed to a big major label. You, over the years, had a number of hit songs, 10, 12, 13, 14, top 10 alternatives, half dozen number one hits, played to millions of people around the planet. You, my friend, Miss Cohen, have taken a decidedly different route to bring attention to yourself as a drummer. You've never been in a band at this point, correct?
Really.
But you've built this thing on YouTube, and I want to play a little video here to give everybody a little taste of what you're doing, and then we're going to come back and talk about this thing that you've built, Miss Cohen. Fire away. All right, we're back. That's a little taste of what Meytal Cohen's been doing. You caught my attention. I don't recall how, but it was before I met you through the Maker Music folks, and it was probably some Incubus fan sending me something. And I recall, I don't know if you remember, Jose, I sent you along a link. I said, Jose, you got to check this girl out. This is fucking sick what she's doing, right? And so now everybody kind of has said, you do cover songs and you do drum tutorials. First of all, tell me how you came up with this angle. Lots of people are doing covers. You're doing drum covers.
Well, first of all, for the Incubus fans, I don't want to forget. I actually covered,
Pardon Me.
Pardon Me. And it doesn't get a lot of views. So all the Incubus fans, go and check it out. And, you know, up that video. It really wasn't a master plan. Like, a lot of people are like commenting like, oh my God, this girl is fucking genius. But it wasn't like nothing intentional. Like, I wasn't thinking, ooh, this is what I'm gonna do. And it's going to be great. But no, it was, you know, I love playing drums. I came here to follow a dream. I didn't have a thing that I thought was going to happen. I don't know what I thought was going to happen, mm-hmm. really, you know. That's what happened. It was like I did everything that other drummers do. I went to auditions and I did all that. But then this video, the one with the violinist, that kind of blew up. And it wasn't intentional that we even made that video just to... as an audition tape for America's Got Talent. And it was
that your first video cover?
It was the first video that really hit big. And
mm-hmm. Now, if you folks haven't seen this video, we've played it, I've played it on my Facebook page and so forth. I wish we had it right now, but we don't. It's awesome. It's just ridiculously good. It also almost made me wish you guys were in System of a Down, frankly. no disrespect, boys, you know, go on, I'm just saying it, you know. But let me ask you this. You said something that was just, I love it, is this notion of the master plan. So many of the people on our site will send me emails and correspond, and in some ways they're looking for kind of a magic
recipe.
If I just do this, right. this, and this, Steve, if I just do all the things you say, will I be successful, right? And what I've found from talking not only to musicians like yourself, but business people and across the board, that more often than not, there was no master plan, but there must have been some voice, something out in the distance calling you that said, okay, this YouTube thing's happening. I love these songs. I'm just gonna play my favorite band's song and I'm gonna record it.
Yeah, that's pretty much.
Okay, but now here's what you did, I thought. I talk a lot about presentation, and Jose has heard all these speeches over the years, so forgive me, Jose. You know, to present it, you know, when you present things properly and highlight all the great things about it, you get a much bigger bang for your buck. You don't just do little, hey, put on the little webcam and do drums. You actually have taken it up a notch. Your videos are very produced in a sense that they have some drama. Talk about how you evolved that or how you came up with that idea.
I can't really take credit for that. Like, there are so many drum covers on YouTube. People have been doing it forever, really. It's not forever because YouTube is still new, but I saw it on YouTube and, you know, I started doing it, and so should you. If you have a talent, I feel like, you know, YouTube is still free. You can do it. No one closed it down yet. Do it now. Start, pushing your stuff. You have a stage, and people from all over the world are going to see what you do. And if you do it good, if you love it, people are going to notice. And that's basically
Did you start with just one camera or two cameras and just added to that?
Well,
or?
The first videos that I made were just with the camera in my room, like the drum set next to the bed. And,
yep. yep.
It sounds terrible. It looks very bad. And so I had a few of these, and then a few live ones from a tour where someone was, I did a solo, not a very complicated one or anything, but a few of these, and I did get some subscribers, but I find that when you commit to something and when you're consistent and when you have a certain level of quality that people know that they can expect, then that is the point where it's going to really work for you. That's when it's going to...
Again, I'll play professor. You mentioned two great words there, this notion of committing, right? The music business... it's a dreamer's business because the chances of succeeding are so slim. To the person, everybody that's ever succeeded in the music business, and I suspect in other businesses, whatever it is, they make a commitment to do it. And that commitment is sometimes blind in a way, where there's the end game is not quite clear. But I love to hear you say that. And I hope all of our viewers out there are taking note of that, because that is once you get through the dreaming bit, and you get to the doing part, which is the part that really tests your mettle. And Jose and I have 20, 17 years where we know those moments where your commitment to it was tested. It is one of the singular most important characteristics of people that are successful and things that you need to do. And consistency is part of it. When you have committed, you don't allow yourself to be taken off track with something that didn't go the way you want, or hadn't gone exactly the way you planned it. And I think it's a huge thing. Tell me about Meytal. You also have a teacher's streak in you a little bit, right? Because you not only are doing the big rock videos, which are very entertaining to watch, you're also doing the teaching that you didn't have when you started. Tell me about that.
Well, I actually did have, I started taking lessons.
Oh, you did? Okay, yeah. My bad, I'm sorry.
From the beginning. But I'm not like a great, I don't think I'm a great teacher or anything. I just really like to inspire other people to do, you know, what I did. It brought a lot of joy to my life, and if I can just even start them in that direction, like, and even if it's not in drums and something else, just showing people that it's possible and it's not like magic. Sometimes people think that like music is like magic and it can't be explained, but it can, and if you practice, you're gonna be good, and that's basically the message.
Yeah, I think it's so great, you know, that when people have some skill and experience that they do share. Jose, you tell me about, you know, our little Incubus HQ drum clinic. I know before we did it, everybody in the band, we had this wacky idea to go out and do some clinics and so forth, but everybody was nervous. But when you got into it, you were terrific. Tell me about that from your point of view, the whole notion of teaching.
You know, I've always sort of had a want to do something like that, so it was a good opportunity to do it. Because I the first clinic that I saw was Tim Alexander from Primus at Guitar Center, and it was awesome. Me and Mike went, and he just played at Guitar Center, and he played a couple of Primus songs and just did a solo, and then just opened up, you know, a Q&A session, and it was cool. It was super cool, and you know, I thought, you know, that's not all that difficult to do. And I think to connect with kids who want to talk about drums, that's sort of an easy thing for me to do. And so, you know, in doing it, I thought it was super fun. I thought people, you know, got a little drum education out of it. And I could see myself doing more of those, you know, and, you know, making it more of doing more of those, just, you know, for fun, for me, to help other kids out, and just sort of in a way give back in a certain sort of way, you know?
I think it's important stuff, and I know that you'd be terrific at it. Here's a question that came in, Meytal, that changing gears just a little bit, but something that really came to my mind as well. There's a gal by the name of Millie out there. He said, Meytal, do you or have you found it harder to be taken seriously as a female drummer in a predominantly male field? Speak to that if you would.
You know, I think there is kind of a stigma, like people think that girls can't play. I do think that there's not a lot of girls playing, period. And the percentage of the guys, if you look at the guys that are playing, and you look at the percentage of the people that do it well, it's the same as if you look at the group of females that are playing. You know, there's just not a lot. So mostly when you see a girl play, she's probably not that good because there's not a lot. So the ones that are good are rare. So there is a stigma that they're not good, which is hard to deal with. It was actually hard for me, more mentally, because you feel like you have to represent, like you have that pressure, like everyone thinks I'm going to suck right now, and it's a lot of pressure mentally. But I don't know if it's actually, like, I think nothing can really stop you from achieving what you want, so I don't think.
Yeah, that's good, because you're actually just doing it, you know. I, you know, and anyone who sees the videos of you playing, like, there's no question you got the ability, and it's, you know, it's great, it's amazing. So, you know, just by your actions, that just speaks volumes, you know. It's really cool to see that.
Yeah, I'm hoping that I've like managed to correct a little like people's notion about female like musicians.
Well, I think from where I sit, it's interesting, the songs that you've chosen are such testosterone fueled songs. And I mean that in a good way. They're such big rock songs that when I saw that video, the very same things that could have potentially held you back, I found magnified the whole effect for me. Because it was just like, look at this chick play drums, because there is that kind of, you know, biased that you wouldn't be able to. So when you light it up like that, I got to tell you, the bang from that drum was big from my perspective. Here's a question for you, Jose, from Millie as well. Yeah, but it's something I hear, interesting to hear both of you speak to. It says, how would you suggest you market and promote yourself as a single drummer versus one already in a band? We got some time off and we're doing more things, you know, with just you. How does that work?
You know, that's a good question. That's something that I'm slowly...
Probably could take a few lessons from
Meytal. Yeah, I was going to say, she's the one who probably can answer that question better than myself, because I'm... You know, I'm actually just starting myself, and I'm learning, you know, and you know, I'm sort of picking your brain about it because I
think you need me for my help.
Well, you're doing it, and you've done an incredible job. So you know, it's cool for me to sort of ask you questions and sort of figure out how can I better myself at doing that. And I think we have all the tools at hand. I mean, the internet's the biggest tool we have, and the easiest, the most. It's free, it's easy, and it reaches, you know,
everywhere.
The world, you know. So I think that's the best place for you to go. And I think probably what Meytal said is just consistency. If you can put yourself out there and do things consistently, slowly people will start coming to it. If you just leave it, you know, to sit by the wayside, then nothing's going to happen.
It must help you, though, that you're like, Incubus.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question.
You have a name for it. You made a name for yourself.
Yeah,
so.
There's no question. But if I don't do anything about it, nothing's going to happen, right? So that's kind of what I'm figuring out now. Huh. Yeah.
I think it's perfect to hear is because, you know, yes, Jose's been in a big band. But if you were judging the scorecard by YouTubes and subscribers and all that stuff, you've done an amazing job. And I think it speaks to everything that's great about the internet and everything that's great about music and the opportunity that the internet provides you to make your mark in the world if you have a passion, if you commit to it, and if you're really good at it. All right, well, we're getting close to the end here, so I wanted to kind of put this in some perspective. If I ask both, and I'll start with Jose first, you know, if you were giving advice to somebody today that's on the fence, that's thinking about it, hasn't quite done it, what would you tell them, Jose?
For someone who wants to play drums
or
a band?
Wants to be a musician, that wants to make music their life and their career.
I think you need to be tenacious. I mean, I think you really need to first follow your heart. If it's something you love, do it, not because you have to, but because of the love of doing it. And really just follow that, whatever that may be. If that's just practicing and getting better, if that's answering ads in a paper, if that's making videos and putting it, you know, on the internet, whatever it may be, just sort of go after it and be consistent and keep doing it. Keep bettering yourself at whatever that thing is that you're doing. And I'd say follow your heart, you know, and that's an easy thing to say, because then there comes in the reality of, well, I need a paycheck, I need to pay bills, I need to take care of my family. You got to figure out how to balance all that. Everyone does. I mean, that's part of, you know, your life. You got to figure out how to balance it. And, you know, it may not happen. You know, it may not happen for you, but if you really love it, I can't imagine someone completely stopping doing what they love, you know. And even if it's just a hobby, still do it. You know, it's a fulfilling of something inside of you. So continue to do it, but you got to give it an effort, you know, and just kind of follow that dream. I mean, Meytal is a perfect example of doing it. I'm an example of doing that. You know, there's plenty of examples out there. Just, you know, just doing it, you know, figuring it out, you know.
Yeah, and I'll say this, you know, it's just wonderful to hear you say it, but the only way you figure it out, in my experience, and I've had a lot of experience, you know, at this point in my life, is you don't find out anything sitting on the sidelines. You got to do it. So Meytal, if I ask you the same question, you have managed to go from this young gal that comes to America with a dream, you're starting to fulfill your dream. If you were giving advice to somebody out there that's on the fence, there was a gentleman that was asking about this, I can't remember his name now, Louis, who was in New York City, he's trying to figure out how to ditch the 9-to-5 Wall Street environment and chase your dream. What would you tell him?
be more available, kind of like what Jose, you need to give it a try, you need to take the risk, and you know, if you need to be a waiter to have more flexibility, and you know, it's things that you have to do. Like, we all are scared to do it at some point, because you're really like, that's the scare. I'm not gonna have the benefits, how am I gonna pay, like, not gonna have medical insurance, I can't do it. It's kind of like a, in Hebrew there's a saying, like a gold prison cell, like it's golden, but it's still a prison cell, like you need to be able to do what you love. So yeah, just start doing it. If you know, if you can't right now, then build your way into being able to do it. Save up, do something.
Yeah, well, I gotta tell you folks, this has been inspiring for me. It really is. I love hanging out with people that are on a mission. I really, really do. And so maybe one day you guys can find something to work on together here. But it's been great having both of you here today, and sharing your advice and thoughts and insights. And I hope some of the folks out there can learn something from all of this. That would make me very happy, guys. So we're going to close up things here by doing a little bit of shameless promotion. Jose knows that I can shamelessly promote. So I'll start here a little bit. Tomorrow, we got another webcaster. We're becoming like, you know, like webcasting specialists.
Good stuff, man.
Yeah. By the way, I wanted to say, for all the people that have been watching our whole thing unfold here, hopefully we're getting a little better at it each week, but we're kind of learning on the job. But this week, I want to tell you about a couple things we've got coming up. Tomorrow, we've got an Ask Renman Live. Every Friday, I go online and I take questions from people out there, musicians, wannabe music industry professionals. And we can do them on the phone, we can do them by chat, we can do them by leaving questions on our board. So tomorrow, I'm going to have a couple guests again. I love it when folks come in, and thank you, folks. We have our German concert promoter, Christian Bilde, who Jose knows, will be joining us to talk about the music business. He comes to town every year about this time to network with managers and agents here in L.A. He actually saw the show and volunteered to be on the show. So our That's friend cool. Christian Bild is going to be here as well. We've also got some wonderfully talented members here on the site that are starting off that deserve some attention. And one of them is a gentleman by the name of Scott Mells. He's an Australian guy who came to America to follow his dream. He's going to come into the studio here, or my office, I should say, and talk about his career. We're going to talk a little shop. And he's also going to play us a couple songs here. Wonderfully talented guy. So maybe you can watch the show tomorrow. For all of you RMB, Renman Music and Business members here in the LA area, or anybody willing to travel, I'm doing my first gig here, Jose. First live speaking engagement.
Here?
No, not here. At the Musicians Institute down in Hollywood at 7:30 p.m. If you're a Renman Music and Business member, you can go to the site, sign up on the event page, and RSVP, and we'll get you. I got 100 free tickets for the Renman folks here. I'll be talking about all the things that I think are part of getting your head in the right place to do something great, and that's what we've been talking about here today. So, recapping a lot of things we talked about. So I hope you'll get a chance to join us. That's next Wednesday, October 3rd. You can choose between watching Barack Obama and Mitt Romney debate. That's exciting fucking stuff. Or come down and hang out with me and we'll have a beer when we're done. I want to thank all of the people who helped me put this thing together. It started with my friend Joe Lilac over here, who is tireless, who helps us with Incubus every single day. And I can't imagine doing all this stuff without him. I got our technical director. Things seem to be going smoothly, more smoothly here today, folks. It's because of professionals, music industry professionals like Darren LeGros, who I've dubbed our technical director, but he's also the audio monitor engineer for Jose. How's he do for you out there? Awesome. I want to also thank our content manager, video editor, Arizona Wildcat. Did I mention the Wildcat part? That's my son, too, Matt Rendog. Rennie is what they call him over there at U of A. I want to thank our wonderfully talented and energetic interns, Jamie Bertle from Tulane University, and Annika Latta, who's a singer in her own right. She goes to school at Northeastern University. Never met either one of them, but they do an unbelievable job for me doing research and social media stuff. I also want to thank my friend and colleague and fellow Sony alum, Vicky Batkin, who's been a great encouragement for me. And finally, I want to thank all the folks that have taken the time here, people like yourself, to come and share their thoughts and insight about the music business. I think it's a great thing for them to do, and I can't tell you how happy I am that they've done it. So, but more than anything, I want to thank all of you folks for joining us here at the RenmanMusicAndBusiness.com. My name's Steve Rennie. This is Renman Live. We'll see you again tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Thanks for joining us. See ya.